Welcome to all. This is the video lecture for control system, and we are going to cover root locus under this video lecture. The topic root locus is going to covered in three lectures. The lecture one is about the basic introduction part, and then the lecture two is about the rules for plotting the root locus, and then in lecture three we are going to see some problem based on these discussion. The learning outcome for the students are, the students are able to explain the root locus, and the second one is understand the basic terminologies used in root locus. When we are studying second order system, we have seen this, when we are changing the value of zeta, we are having different types of root. For example, when we are having zeta equals to 0, we are having purely imaginary roots. And when we are changing the value of zeta from 0 to 1, we are having complex conjugate type of root. And when the value of zeta is equals to 1, we are having real and equal roots. And when we are changing the value of zeta from 1 to infinite, we are having real and different roots. Here we are seeing that we are changing the value of parameter zeta, that is damping factor, from 0 to infinity. And if we plot these trajectories of the poles, then what we have is called as root locus. So from this discussion, one thing is very clear, that we are going to vary a parameter from 0 to infinite and plot the trajectories of the root. And at that time, I mentioned that we are going to cover this topic in detail. So, what is root locus? Root locus is the locus of the root or the trajectories of the root of the characteristic equation of the system when the system parameter, generally we have taken the gain of the system as the parameter. And what we are going to do that parameter, we are going to change that parameter value from 0 to infinity. Now, there are some condition for the root locus. If we are having a system like that, where k is a gain, and the closed loop transfer function of the given system can be write as kgs upon 1 plus gshs, and the characteristic equation for the system is 1 plus kgshs. In the S plane, any point S is satisfy this condition, means that point S is the root of the characteristic equation. From this we are having two conditions. The first one is the magnitude condition, and the another one is the phase condition. What are these conditions and what are the significance of these conditions? Is simply, if any point S is the part of the root locus, means it is having, it is a solution of the characteristic equation. So the magnitude at that, the inverse of the magnitude at that point is the gain or gain k of the system, and the phase contributed by the loop transfer function at that point is always a odd multiple of 180 degree. Means if we are having a question like a point is given S in the S plane, and in question it is asked that whether that point is a part of the root locus or not, then we are going to check these two conditions. If these two conditions are satisfied, then we are going to tell that yes, that point S in the S plane is the part of the root locus. And especially the second condition, that is the phase condition, is very important. In our root locus, we are going to calculate two things from this condition only. The first one is identifying the real axis segment, and the another one is the angle of departure and angle of arrival for the complex pole and the complex zeros of the system. Now we are going to understand some terminologies used in root locus. We are not going to bother about how we are going to find these things, because that is going to cover in lecture 2. Here just we are going to familiar with these terminologies. First of all, branches. Here in the system, we can see that there are four poles at 0, minus 1, minus 2, and minus 4. And we are having one zeros as minus 3. There are other zeros are also available. There are four poles, four finite poles, and one finite zero. There are three infinite zeros which are located at infinite. So every root locus branch is going to start from the poles and it is going to end at a zeros. So here we can see that four branches, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So what is the conclusion? The conclusion is the number of branches is equal to the number of poles. So here we are having four poles. So correspondingly we are having four branches. And now the second point is, when the value of k is equal to 0, the root locus plot is going to start from the poles and end at zeros. So here we are having only one finite zero, and this branch is going to start from the pole, that is at minus 2, and end at a zero, that is at minus 3. What about the other three poles? The other three poles are going towards the infinity by following some asymptotes. Fine. The other three poles are going towards the infinity by following an asymptotes. So there are four finite poles and three and one finite zero. So three branches are going towards the infinity by following the asymptotes. And don't bother about how we are going to find these asymptotes. These all are going to cover in the lecture 2. Now we have to find which segment of the root locus are the which segment of the real axis are the part of the root locus. For that we have to follow a simple rule. Let's take this point. If the number of poles and zeros to the right of that point is odd, then that point is the part of the root locus. Here we have taken this point. So at the right of that point, the number of poles and zeros are zero, means even number. So this point is not the part of the root locus. Let's take this point. Here we can see that to the right of that point, single pole is means odd. So that is the part of the root locus. Not only this point, all the points which are located from 0 to minus 1 is having odd number of poles and zeros towards its right. So the segment from 0 to minus 1 is the part of the root locus. Let us take this point. Here we are having 3 poles and 1 zero, means 4. So again an even number, so this point is not the part of the root locus. If we have taken our point here, then there are 4 poles and 1 zeros, means 5 number of poles and zeros, odd numbers. So this point is the part of the root locus. From minus 4 to minus infinite is the part of the root locus. Then the other thing is, all the asymptotes are going to intersect each other on real axis, and that is called as centroid. Again, by using simple formula we can find these things. Don't bother about that. Here again there are two terms, breaking point and breakaway point. First of all, let's find which segment of the real axis is the part of the root locus. If we have take our point here, then no poles and no zeros. So 0 means even. So this is not the part of the root locus. If we have taken our point here, yes, number of poles and zeros is 1 odd. So this point is the part of the root locus. Not only this point, all the points from minus 1 to minus 2 is the part of the root locus. Now take the point at here, and here again 2 poles and 1 zeros odd in numbers. So all the points from minus 3 to minus 4 is the part of the root locus. And I have already told the root locus is always start from the poles and end at zeros, and number of branches equals to the number of poles. So here we are having 2 poles, we are having 2 branches over there, these 2 branches. And now when we are increasing the value of k, for a particular value of k, these 2 poles meet at a point, and that point is called as breakaway point. Breakaway means the real roots are going to be complex. So when the roots are converting itself from real to complex, then that point is called as breakaway point, and the opposite is breaking point. And we can find the coordinates of or position of these breaking and breakaway point by simply calculating the maximum minima problem by solving the dk by ds. And the dk by ds, we are going to find it from the characteristic equation. Again, we are going to see how we are going to calculate this thing in lecture 2. And now the angle of departure and angle of arrival. When we are having complex poles, then that pole is going to depart. So that angle is called as angle of departure. And when we are having a complex zeros, some poles are going to arrive at that zeros, as we know that the root locus branch is start from a pole and end at a zero. So some poles are going to arrive at that pole. So the angle of arrival for the complex poles. And we can find this angle of departure and angle of arrival from the same phase condition which we have seen in the starting, that is the total angle contributed by the loop transfer function is equals to the odd multiple of 180 degree. Thank you. And these are my references.